The views expressed and opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of ZTalk Radio, its affiliates, or sponsors.
You're listening to the Dark Shadows Radio with your host, Al Warren, only on the ZTalk Radio Network.
Welcome to the Dark Shadows. I'm your host, Al Warren. Tonight we have parapsychologist Loyd Auerbach. He's a well-known and leading expert on ghosts and psychic experience. With a master's degree in parapsychology, he is the director of the Office of Paranormal Investigations. He's also a professor at Atlantic University and at JFK University. He was also recently appointed to the board of directors of the Rhine Research Center. He is also a co-author of a book, The Ghost Hunter's Guide to Haunted San Francisco. We're going to talk to him about his book, his life, being a parapsychologist, and the world at large, right after these words.
Listen to us anytime, anywhere now. Download our free app now for the iPhone and iPad. Look for the Warren Exchange or House of Mystery app at the Apple App Store today.
Welcome back to The Dog Show. Up next, we have Satchmo. Satchmo is a member of the Shelter Pet Group.
That's right, a group known especially for their couch-snuggling, ball-chasing, face-licking, tail-wagging, backyard-hanging, and of course, companionship.
And what breed would you say Satchmo is?
I'd have to go with maybe a lavish terrier hound chihuahua looking kind of mix.
Tremendous dog.
I'd also like to point out Satchmo's coloring, a white, gray, brown, black brindle. Simply marvelous.
You know, it's such a treat to watch a dog like this.
Now, let's see him in action.
Look how he makes eye contact with his person.
That's actually known as the treat stare.
How intuitive. And now he appears to be excitedly turning in circles.
Ah, the happy dance, so common with this group.
And finally, the loving face lick.
It's great how he just gets in there and, well, licks.
Fantastic. But really, the best way to know an amazing shelter pet like Satchmo is to meet one.
Visit theshelterpetproject.org today. Adopt.
Brought to you by Maddie's Fund, the Humane Society of the United States, and the Ad Council.
Introducing the Starbucks Flat White. Crafted with two ristretto shots for bolder, caramelly espresso. Whole milk, steamed to a sweet, velvety microfoam. Delicately poured, so the espresso rises to the top. The perfect union of bold and sweet. Simplicity is its own artistry.
Who knows what evil lurks in the hearts of men? The shadow knows.
Well, they're doing an awful lot with ESP these days.
What's that?
ESP? Extrasensitive perception.
And joining us is Loyd Auerbach, and we appreciate you for taking the time to do the show again.
Thanks, Al.
Yeah. So, now, let's talk a little bit about you. Now, it looks like you've got quite the history. Now, you've got a master's degree in parapsychology. You're the director of the Office of Paranormal Investigations and president of Forever Family Foundation. Tell us a little bit about that, like the Forever Family Foundation.
Well, the foundation was started a little over 10 years ago by a couple who had lost their daughter in an accident. And they had been grieving quite a bit, and it turned out that a medium that was being seen by one of their friends got a message from their daughter. And Bob and the couple's Bob and friend Ginsburg, and they Bob was very skeptical, but over a short period of time, with the amount of evidence that came through the medium directly from their daughter Bailey, they really were convinced, and it actually made them feel good. It helped them through their grief significantly. And they decided to, once they found other people who had had significant help in their grieving from mediums, decided to start a foundation to support the work of mediums in the family grieving process, and also to support the research work in a variety of areas of looking at experiences of life after death, survival of bodily death. So everything from controlled research in the laboratory of mediums to apparition research, reincarnation, and so on.
Wow, that sounds like quite a... whereabouts is that located?
The foundation is headquartered on Long Island in New York, but there are members mostly in the United States, but all over the world. People can join for free. You might say that the foundation is headquartered on the web these days, since we're doing webinars, and they have a weekly radio show. And it's foreverfamilyfoundation.org. But again, people can join for free, and there's a twice-a-year magazine and activities here and there, although they've been mainly centered in the Northeast. We're trying to get them out in other parts of the country as well.
Is there a goal? Like, what exactly are you trying to accomplish from this now that it's up and running?
Well, there's two goals. The primary goal is actually education and helping the public understand what mediumship is, and what the evidence is for life after death in general. The secondary goal is to support mediums and the idea of mediumship and the grieving process by actually, I guess you could say, vetting good mediums. And they have a certification program, which they'll do every so often, even at a distance, to see how evidential the mediums are, and then also just do some background checks and such to make sure that the mediums have some other background. And the mediums who go through the certification process to stay certified have to volunteer part of their time. Not a lot, but they do have to volunteer every year some hours to the foundation, since the foundation is a 501c3 nonprofit volunteer organization.
Okay. And as president, how do you see your role there?
Well, I've been president for a couple of years now, and I've presided over a couple of our conferences. We actually were running annual conferences until it became evident that there's too many other similar conferences out there that are drawing people away. But I presided over them, and those were conferences that brought together scientists who were doing research both in the field and in the laboratory, as well as mediums who are part of the foundation for the general public. And now I'm kind of overseeing some projects we've got. We do have a project we're working on to reach out to other organizations in the parapsychology and consciousness world and see if we can help spur on a lot more kind of cross pollination and support for each other. So the whole idea here is this is about family, and we're trying to make this more about, you know, about not just individual families, but about the family of man, so to speak. But yeah, when it comes to this kind of these concepts.
Yeah, and that's quite interesting, actually. Now, you're a parapsychologist, and the few that I know quite well, for the most part, tend to stay away from the mediums and the ghost hunting and things like that. And
Is there a reason in general for that? Is it just like you feel like it's going to be bad for your reputation, or?
Well, you know, a lot of my colleagues are laboratory-based, and they have to deal within the strictures of laboratory research, and actually some of them are in either connected to academia or in academic situations where they have to be extremely careful because there's so much prejudice against any of these topics in and from academia. Others, you know, some of them don't necessarily believe in themselves in life after death, and they look at experiences with mediums, for example, as examples of extraordinary psychic ability, but not necessarily communicating with the dead. You know, I have to say that part of this also is why they stay away from it is who funding sources are, and there are so few funders that they have to stick with what they can best sell to the funding organizations, the foundations that do the funding. And in fact, those same foundations have funded mediumship research. It's just that the parapsychologists themselves were not necessarily first in it, or just not their personal interest.
Right, right.
You know, as far as I want to say something about the ghost hunting thing. You know, field investigation is something that is you never get funded for that. So that's another reason why a lot of parapsychologists don't do any of that.
Yeah. Well, you know, so I think the role of what a parapsychologist does and actually what they are is confusing for a lot of the mainstream people, for listeners. I don't think they quite get it. What is a parapsychologist?
Parapsychologist is someone who studies psychic phenomena, psychic experiences, and that runs the gamut from extrasensory perception, which includes things like telepathy and precognition and remote viewing, clairvoyance, to psychokinesis, which is the concept of mind over matter, and we have different types of research we do there. Mostly the lab research is done with computers and random event generators because it can be very difficult to control for fraud when you're talking about things that are happening in somebody's hands, and we have seen a lot of fraud over the decades. And then, of course, parapsychology also covers looking into survival of bodily death. Many parapsychologists are actually very interested in things like near-death experiences. And the University of Virginia has a whole division, a department that, Department of Perceptual Studies at the medical school, that looks at things like evidence of reincarnation from children who remember past lives and near-death experiences, out-of-body experiences. So, you know, we cover the gamut, but again, some people are more dedicated to the laboratory and other people really reach out and look at experiences in the real world. But even the laboratory researchers are aware of and look at the experiences in the real world because that informs what they're doing in the lab. And people who are doing the other, those of us who do field research, have to keep up on what's going on in the laboratory because that's where things get tested. So, you know, like psychology, there's, you know, laboratory and out of the laboratory, you know, it's experimental and non-experimental. And while we may not be counselors, we are educators talking about and providing information about this.
Well, where do you draw the line on evidence? Like when you're gathering evidence as a parapsychologist, that means you're trying to do it scientifically. Because a lot of what's shown to the public, I think this is where the problem becomes. A lot of that is the loudest beep or the biggest noise or the biggest thing on their whatever item of electronics they're using. But nobody really explains that. Nobody really goes into that.
You know, most of those people who you see on the ghost hunting shows have no concept of science, and they have no concept of parapsychology. The shows have been very carefully avoiding the field that's been studying this subject for well over 100 years because they don't want researchers, whether they're field group researchers like myself or laboratory researchers, to take away from the so-called talent, as they call them, the teams that are focused on in the show, and that's drama. I mean, they're not meant to be science shows. And unfortunately, what's happened because of these shows, that even if the people on the TV shows, which I suspect only some of them do, knew what the equipment does and cannot do, what it can and cannot do, the producers have crafted the or edited the episodes so that you're not getting the whole story. You know, you're not getting, if they get a big beep and they get excited, and then the next moment they figure out what, that there's some other cause, some non-paranormal cause for that, pretty evident, you're not seeing the non-paranormal cause on that show because they've edited it out. So the sad thing is, I think, and it speaks to, unfortunately, a segment of the American public, believing reality TV is what it, you know, is only what you see on TV without asking questions about what's missing or what's really going on, is a deficit in our education system.
Right. We've become crystallized in thought. We're no longer trying to figure out things or question them.
And the media, you know, frankly, the media has been, you know, even the news media has been responsible for undercutting this. You know, when it's in the entertainment industry, I don't really blame them because they're trying to put together entertaining shows. Although with the reality shows, that the people on the shows are not allowed to make public statements about what's real and what's not because of their contracts, that's a failing of that industry. But going back to Ghostbusters, when that movie came out, you know, suddenly reporters and media were asking the simple question, we know it's not like this, what's it really like? Although producers were still asking if we had any equipment that had pretty lights and made a lot of noise because they're television.
Yeah. Well, there you have it. So it hasn't really gone a long way. Is there anything, I think, that you find watchable? And I don't mean that in a bad way, but just anything you find redeemable in watching the ghost hunting shows right now on TV?
Well, personally, I don't watch them. I find them boring. I'd rather watch a scripted show that actually has some thought cut behind it. You know, I've worked in reality TV here and there. You know, I've done my own segments, and I actually have been involved in several show pitches for reality shows and development, where we can find ways to make the shows interesting to a greater segment of the population, not just the ghost hunting fans. But most of the TV people are not interested. They're interested in only doing what they think works or what they've seen work. The shows that I've seen that have been interesting, there was a show from Canada called Ghostly Encounters, where people actually told their own ghost stories. They found people who could tell a good story, who had an experience, positive, negative, neutral, and that was an interesting show because it's kind of what we do. We talk to people and find out what their experiences are, and that was well done, and it was pretty clear that the people, they just simply found good people or people who could tell a good story, as opposed to prompting the people what to say. So it's shows like that I find interesting.
Yeah, there's more of a sense of reality. It's like talking to a witness. So it's something you know, you can pick something out of that. And
Even the celebrity paranormal shows, you know, when they're telling their stories, they found, you know, actors and actresses who had experiences. Those are more interesting than the ghost hunting shows. And it just, you know, when I see these shows, we do not investigate in the dark, and the only reason people are investigating dark is because of television. You know, it has nothing to do with science. It has nothing to do with our history and parapsychology. It has nothing to do with people's experiences. They've created this mythology around how and why ghosts appear, and oddly, a lot of it comes from, you know, beliefs of psychics or things psychics have said over the last 100 years, you know, and even the phony mediums would say, well, ghosts can only appear in the dark. So what these shows that are using that mythology, that folklore, at the same time are saying, we're not going to work with psychics because psychics are useless. So they're using the information from psychics they don't even believe in to create a mythology or folklore that people are believing in.
Yeah. Well, I know I look thinner in the dark, so... I prefer that.
Do you in an infrared using a Sony night shot camera?
Oh, no, maybe not. Second thought. Well, where would that come from? But why would they say it has to be in the dark? It just creates an atmosphere, and it's easier to kind of scare people or get them
exactly.
into it.
Exactly. Yeah. Back when I started doing television in the 80s, the number of times we went out on either to haunted locations, the producers would always, or director with us would say, can we lower the lights? Can we make sure we do this at night, even though the people are experiencing things during the daytime? Can you turn the lights out? Now, fortunately, you know, the camera guys are saying, well, we can't turn the lights out because then you won't see anything.
Yeah.
And then, of course, all of a sudden, we had Sony night shot cameras and the infrared camera showing in the dark. And even more than just being able to see in the dark is people's eyes shined and things look spooky. So they had their own very inexpensive atmospheric use of technology that allowed them to make things even spookier. And it just, a couple of the shows started doing that in the early 2000s, and all of a sudden, you know, it looks good on camera, it looks good on TV, and TV is a visual image medium, so you're always trying to come up with something visual. And rather than having people wander around or walk around a place with the lights on, you know, you can at least create some suspense because they're in the dark, and the odds are that something's going to happen in the dark. You know, the fact is that people are, and this is scientifically documented. There have been studies showing people are terrible observers in the dark.
Right. So, well, yeah.
You know.
I mean, our eyes aren't as good. I think that anytime you have that, and when you're put in a situation with a feeling like the darkened room, the whole atmosphere mm-hmm. is what sells it. Like, it puts preconceived notions into your mind.
Of course.
And they'll all be different because we're all slightly different, but it still puts something in our mind. So I think it's really hard, and that leads me to how do you really scientifically research something like this where you can't really prove it? I mean, you can bring pieces of evidence into it,
right? But you know, proof in science, you know, the word proof is overrated in science.
Yeah,
because there's very little that's actually been proven. You know, we experience gravity, but what gravity is has not been proven.
Right.
You know, there are many things that have significant evidence that have theory. You do want theory, and you want to be able to explain these things. And that leads to what we would consider proof or acceptance. But here, let's start with the root of it. What we're starting with here is a human experience. A person experiences a ghost. A person witnesses something happening. You don't have physical evidence, except maybe the aftermath. So if it's a poltergeist case where things are moving around, you might have some broken stuff. And you might even be able to, if you're lucky, catch it on camera moving. But even then, you still have to watch the video, and you have to question whether the video was legitimate or whether it was faked. Parapsychology is social science. We are dealing with human experiences. Living or dead, we're still dealing with human experiences. And like all social science, the evidence is based on people's subjective experience and an attempt at objectively understanding what those experiences relate to. We can apply the scientific method, but not so well in the field because we're not in total control like we would be in a laboratory. We can still apply some of it. So you might say that the investigation part of the field is applied science. We're applying what we learn in the laboratory, what we've learned in history, to the investigations in the field.
Right. Well, you being at your master's level in it, you must have some sort of belief in
mm-hmm.
in what's going on and the attempt to let's say get evidence in this area. How is it now? Did you have personal experiences with, as what we say, supernatural or paranormal in your earlier life that had led you down this kind of path?
No, it's just because I was a bit of a science fiction and comic book nerd.
Okay.
More than anything else.
Yeah.
I was a little science geek as a kid, interested in astronomy and geology, among other things. And I also love mythology and science fiction and comic books. I mean, and somewhere in the 60s, it was probably a combination of hearing about ESP in a couple TV shows. There certainly, I saw ghost shows like the old Topper TV series and One Step Beyond, which dramatized actual psychic experiences, which caught my attention as a little kid. And then the comic books themselves occasionally talked about ESP and about psychic powers. And then comes along Star Trek, which involved that quite a bit, and Dark Shadows,
right,
which sent me to the library, and I surprisingly and easily found books on parapsychology by people like J.B. Rhine, who was the kind of father of modern parapsychology. And being a science geek, I read the books that talk about laboratory research. I was really interested in it, and I even was able to get a couple of my teachers to help sponsor a parapsychology club in high school. But it was never about an experience I had had until much later. I certainly had experiences since I got into the field, and I met psychics, actually. I met parapsychologists in high school thanks to one of my neighbors who knew a couple of them in the New York area, and I actually connected with people in college and after, so I was kind of led along a path to get involved in the field. But, personally, I was undecided. Even with all the literature that I read, I was certainly leaning towards the concept that survival of bodily death was happening from the literature and from what people had found, but one of my early cases actually left me with no other alternative that made sense. So I kind of, that's when that started developing.
Right. And there is, now there is a difference with, I think there's the whole picture of consciousness. Like we survive, our mm-hmm. mind survives after our body dies.
Right.
As well as what's left behind.
Right now we have no consensus in science. There's consensus in small parts of in segments of science, but there's no real consensus to what consciousness is. Not even a good definition.
Right.
And the question for people looking at survival of bodily death is, what is it that survives? That's the question. There's a secondary question: is how is it that thing that survives can communicate or connect, interact? And for us, that if consciousness survives, the way ghosts or apparitions actually interact is through psychic ability. I mean, they can't even see they don't even have eyes. So how in the world can they see the world except maybe with their direct consciousness, which is the very definition of ESP. But we're kind of stuck here because we don't know about consciousness in the body to say that there is something or is not something, there. Is there something that could survive? And I think that until we're just not there in science in general to be able to know for sure which that is.
Yeah, yeah. And, that's got to lead to another issue because it seems like no matter where I go in this field, whether any type of paranormal or crypto or UFO, the term and the thoughts of religion always come in. And now that's got, and you were mentioning reincarnation, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so that has got to affect you. Like if you were brought up as a certain type of religion and how you see God, per se, and death is already kind of pre-put in. It's kind of, pre-code it.
Well, you're programmed, just like any education programs us in certain directions and certain beliefs. Reincarnation is believed by more than a billion people on the planet. It's not a small belief. There are many variations of or flavors of reincarnation belief. We in our field stick with young children who spontaneously recall past lives. And while it seems that that's what's going on, there are some other folks who are trying to work on some other possibilities, including, genetic memory or even accessing memory. We don't even know where memory is stored in the brain, so there's that issue too. But there's other issues that might lead to some different interpretations for reincarnation, one of which actually is possession. People have even suggested that it's really a spirit that just kind of temporarily possessing the kid and working through them. So you have different interpretations where reincarnation, the idea at least that some part of that person's the former person's personality has survived, whether it is memory alone or consciousness intact, is hard to say. But you're right. I mean, religion does inform that. But the fact is that most major religions have talked about reincarnation as a possibility, even if it's only been a minor possibility. And that includes Christianity in its early days. It's just that sometimes as religions evolve over time, which they do, and people translate and retranslate and decide what's canon and what's not, you include things that may be, or you, I should say, exclude things that are not politically expeditious.
Right. Right. And also by being pre-coded by this, if you have a certain thought of what reincarnation is and what's going to happen, mm-hmm. and also how you see your God, so, you know, you're passing through the light and your God is got a beard and a cape and white.
Right, right.
And as compared to, you know, like, it doesn't that fall in, like you were talking about NDEs, like near-death experiences.
Yeah.
And I know I've had a few people on that subject. And it seems to me from what they've told me and that you almost... the person almost sees what's kind of they should see as the right. religion.
There is definitely a cultural religious context. So people will either see relatives if they're going to see anybody or at all. They may see a being of light, just simply some light which they may interpret as an angel if they want to call it that. But in some cross-cultural studies, people have. Hindus have seen Hindu gods, Christians have seen Christ or one of the apostles. Other people have seen, specific interpretations of what they consider God. Some people have just heard the voice of the presence, of God. And people, there have been experiences from atheists, by the way. They don't believe in God. They've typically run into their relatives or some unnamed sense of coming back, of being sent back. So there is an interpretation here, but that the core experience seems to be the same, generally the same for the best of the NDEs, of course. And there's no question religion does inform us to some extent. I grew up in a very reformed Judaic family, and I don't believe in demons, because there are no demons. We were taught. First of all, I was even taught, and even my grandfather was Orthodox. He was even taught that you don't take the Bible literally. This is something to discuss. So the stories are allegorical or parables from which you learn if they're not strict, necessarily all strict history, take literally. And we haven't seen really the evidence of demonic presences in our field at all. And harmful things, sometimes people can be bullies, I guess, after death, just like there are bullies in life, but we don't really get the demon thing.
Right.
And even the angel thing is interpretation.
Right. So I kind of get that because that's sort of a little bit how I believe it. I don't believe in a demon angel per se. I think that perhaps it's someone that's passed over or left some residual that happens to go along with the personality of when they were mm-hmm. alive. They might just be an ass. And,
right, exactly. Unfortunately, there's an awful lot of those.
Yeah. We seem to get more and more all the time, and they get more press time too now.
Well, yeah, and this is a good the whole thing of the TV shows. I have informed these ghost hunting groups, and it's just crazy to me that I'll get people telling me, well, we just went into a house and there was a demonic presence. I said, well, how do you know there was a demonic presence? I said, well, because we got an EVP of a voice saying, "Get out." I said, really?
Yeah.
And did you, were you friendly when you walked in, or did you challenge the ghost or something like that? Because personally, if I was a ghost and you came in yelling at me, which a lot of ghost hunting groups like to do, I would be saying things stronger than "get out." I might even hit somebody upside the head.
Yeah.
but to me, they're acting rude and they're acting like demons, not the ghost.
Yeah. That's sort of, I think that they take things out of context. And,
totally.
And it seems to go in fads, how there's poltergeists and then now the mm-hmm. demon is the word of the year for sure this year.
Yeah, I actually saw a video last year of some group that went into an abandoned building, which was open air, and in an area that apparently had wild dogs, and they got an EVP supposedly of a growling something. Now, there are wild dogs running around, which they even admitted in the thing, and they called it a demon. To me, that they were looking for something to label that way. Most likely it was an actual dog that none of them heard at the time.
Yeah. I just... How do you... Yeah, but that's a tough one. How do you draw the line? Because I notice in your books, one of them was the ghost detectives, the guide to mm-hmm. Haunted San Francisco. So you're kind of... So if you're out actually investigating, how do you draw the line when you think someone is talking about demons and possessions and frankly,
we always have conversations with people up front about their cases, and if somebody thinks it's demonic or evil, I do, first of all, on the phone, besides the pre-interview, I do give them some background and let them know that we typically find that what happens is that these things are not as evil as you think they are. You know, they may be harmful, and we can see what we can do about that, but jumping to that conclusion is difficult. I give the example of the ghost hunters who say that it's demonic because somebody said get out. And most people kind of understand, the whole idea is to reduce the fear. You definitely don't want to tell people that you think it's evil or demonic. Certainly not before an actual investigation on site, before you figure things out. Because all too often, people are, for whatever reason, sometimes because of the TV shows or a horror film, imagining sounds and things that they've heard that are actually explainable as something that could indicate a demon being present. You rarely ever have people actually being attacked, at least in their reports. So we have to kind of educate them. And if I run into somebody who just absolutely positively will not even consider that it's anything but a demon, my question is, why do they want a scientist to come in? You know, we don't deal in demons.
Right.
So, you know, I'm sorry that, you know, I can come in, and the question is, are you going to listen to me? And I have to consider that, because if we can't do any good when we're going in an investigation, they need to be referred out to somebody from a religious perspective.
Right, right. You know, they just had that on television. I still haven't watched it, where they were going to do a live exorcism on...
That house, yeah. You know, first of all, there were four cases that Blatty based the exorcist on. That's number one. Number two, I haven't heard of anything saying that any of those houses are still haunted. And then the third thing is that an exorcism is of a person, not a place.
Right.
You can call that a house clearing or cleansing, but it's certainly not an exorcism. And you don't need a religious figure to do it. You can do it, you know, psychics can do it, and there are other ways you can do it, for that matter. But I would want to know, I haven't seen, I didn't record, unfortunately, forgot to record the show, but I'm curious as to how did they establish the place was still haunted?
Well, I don't think...
are there living witnesses, or just simply that was the house the exorcist was based on?
Well, I just don't think it really mattered. Yeah.
Not for TV.
No.
I did hear it felt totally flat.
You know, it was one of the, because usually I'm all in it. I've got so many things going on, and I, mm-hmm. yeah, like you, I would have it pre-recorded, and then I'd skim through it to see if there looked like there's anything interesting. I found very little follow-up on it. I didn't bother. It's one of those I just didn't bother. I just kind of, wow, no.
Yeah.
It's gone too far. And,
I think that going too far is that show Naked and Paranormal that's going to come up soon.
Well, yeah, you know...
That's gone too far.
You know, just turn the volume off. I can have it running while I'm doing interviews in the studio, and it depends what they look like.
No. Yeah, but they're going to blur out the best parts.
If you're going to blur it, then don't bother.
Yeah, right.
Right. I mean, come on. We're adults here. Come on. But isn't this a problem? This is one thing I still have coming across. Now, how come, in your mind, you see so many popular ghost hunting shows, and everybody wants to be a ghost hunter, and you can go on Facebook, and you can go on any of the social medias,
yeah.
And there's thousands and thousands, and there's new groups every day. And
right, yeah. One of my students actually has done a survey and found email addresses or websites for over 3,000 groups in the United States alone.
So, what is that?
It is the new Star Trek fandom. That's what
okay.
it is. I think it's kind of a form of fandom, but in this case, unlike with Star Trek or Doctor Who, you really can't have your own TARDIS, and you really can't be on the Enterprise. You can buy some inexpensive equipment, and you can go out and emulate them. You know, I think that if people could actually get away with going out and fighting crime, they were watching the TV show Cops would probably have generated the same thing.
Right.
To some extent, if they, you know, if they weren't personally going to be in physical danger from criminals. So it's just the nature of television to and movies to have fans, and this is a group of fans who emulate what they see on TV without questioning. I mean, there's a small percentage of them that either immediately or after working with the groups realize, yeah, this can't be right, and they do seek out educational opportunities, of which there are many now, to understand how one should really do this and what the phenomena really might be. They recognize that a couple of guys who work for Roto-Rooter, who admit to never having read anything or having done any research or invested or any education, how can they possibly do anything more than stumble around in the dark? You know, because they're not checked. They're certainly not. They may encounter some stuff, but their conclusions are based on stumbling around in the dark. They're not based on anything that has gone before or any actual research. So people just like to do it. It's a fun thing. I think that most of the ghost hunters out there are, they are thrill seekers, a lot of them. The ones I have a problem with are ones who suddenly become professionals, that's
right.
Number one,
yeah.
Usually because they buy a lot of equipment.
Yeah.
Or claim to be scientific because they have a lot of equipment and clearly on their website, it's very clear they don't understand science. They think that science and technology are equivalent, and they're not.
Yeah.
and they do more harm than good when they're going out there to private homes. You know, the public locations, it doesn't matter as much, but for private homes, it makes a big difference.
Yeah.
And even the ghost conferences tend to be fan fests. You know, if they don't have one of the celebrity ghost hunters there, you're not going to have a successful conference. So the idea of bringing somebody like me or Barry Taff or my colleagues in as the headliners, that would never work for them because their base is the fans of the shows.
Yeah. I actually got invited to one last year, and the Ghost Hunters were there, and who was that? Ben Hansen, you know, from Fact or Faked and all that.
Right.
So I was on day two at the very bottom of the poster.
I did a couple conferences when the guys from Paranormal State actually had conferences in Pennsylvania, and one of them we had a huge panel with the guys from Ghost Hunters and a couple other para celebrities, including Chip Coffey and some of the producers and all. And I effectively, decided to butt in a few times when a couple of those para celebrities made statements that were absolutely patently untrue and stupid.
Yeah.
And fortunately had backup from another author, Michelle Belanger, who's also very knowledgeable.
Yeah, she is. Very, very smart.
She backed me up. But, to hear someone who is a major TV celebrity on these shows say, there's no literature in this field before the 1990s. And here I am sitting there, and they'd already mentioned my first book, which came out in 1986, so let alone that. But, I spoke up and said, this field goes back to the 1800s, and there's free stuff on the Internet, and the books are up on the Internet before 1923, and how can you possibly say there's nothing there? It's only because you never looked.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think it's just another area that's out there that people have no research in it. It's like the media. There's so many people that just do what they're doing, but they haven't really sat down and read a book or did something to really try to gather some information. And
I had a really surprising moment, and I call it my William Shatner Get a Life moment, where I was at a conference in Pennsylvania for somebody else, and there were 200 people in the audience, and I was doing a lecture on parapsychology for ghost hunters. And I put up a picture of some resource books, most of which I knew that people would not know, but I put up a picture at the time of Deborah Blum's book, The Ghost Hunters, which had been out relatively recently and had even made the New York Times bestseller list about the early days of the ghost hunters in the field of parapsychology and psychical research. And I asked if anybody had read the book, and two hands go up, and they were both my students. and then I said, how many of you knew about the book? And those same two hands and one or two others go up. And I frankly kind of lost it for a moment. I was nonplussed. I was like, how can you people call yourselves ghost hunters and not know about a book that's even in the mainstream?
yeah.
called the Ghost Hunters. How do you not know?
Well,
and it got me in trouble.
Yeah, well, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think that it's gone to and most of those now, all the conferences are all very much the same. It's the same people on the circuits going around and around. And you can get on it, and you can get on the circuit and kind of do that. I like to get off just as fast as I get on. It's just it seems to waste a lot of time. It's a waste of time for me.
It is. I would love to do them, but they're for me to do them, they have to pay me.
Yeah.
And you know, at least the TV people, a lot of times they're not necessarily being paid by the conference. If they still are on television, it's most likely the network is paying for them to be there.
Yeah.
So that's another reason for the conference people to actually have them, because it's promotional for the show and they don't have to take anything away from what they're making on the conference.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, for me it was just networking and meeting some people that I found interesting. But then again, it seems to be most of the time you go, you don't really meet, you know, the interesting people. It's more like Michelle Blanchet or even yourself or Barry Taft. It's very seldom you meet any of that.
Yeah,
it's more of the, you know.
It's because most of the time they don't want us there, or we're too expensive for them.
Well, yeah, And yeah, it's just, so I'm sort of, you know, but you know, the UFO thing hasn't taken off like this. Like,
Not in the same way, for instance,
I can turn around and start up a little thing here. I'm a ghost hunter on, and I like to form a team and we can do this and I can get t-shirts and we can all be happy. But what I mean is, and I can also tell people, oh yeah, no, I have a radio show that covers in ghosts and paranormal, and people for the most part, oh wow, that's cool, oh wow, and they talk about the ghosts and stuff, but people are still scared to come out about being UFOs and like, oh yeah, I was abducted or I saw something or I saw UFOs. They still don't. They're not running out the same way. I mean,
well, I would think you're probably right. Well, first of all, you can't really create a team to go do investigations of that, because first of all, you'd have to find out when people saw the UFO, and the only thing you can do is interview the witness in general. I mean, if it's a situation where it's a close encounter of the second kind, where there's physical evidence, you at least have that. But in general with UFOs, you're dealing with people, it's like somebody saw a ghost and the ghost is not there in the house anymore pretty clearly. Do you go out and do an investigation? And that's more interviewing. In college, I knew Jalen Hynek fairly well. He was the head of the astronomy department at Northwestern. I even volunteered for the Center for UFO Studies for a year. And, you know, they really study, ufologists study UFO reports for the most part, because you typically don't have physical evidence left behind, just like you don't have it in ghost cases. But at least in the paranormal cases, there's a good chance that the phenomena is still going on. Whereas with UFOs, you'd have to establish that the UFO comes regularly or comes once in a while.
Yeah.
And that just generally doesn't happen. So there is that element, number one. Number two, UFOs are outside us. So some other agency is appearing and letting you see, whereas with ghosts, they are either connected to a location or connected to people, but we're also dealing with people if we have ghosts there. So the idea of repetition is pretty likely, and that makes it easier to talk about it, because more people will have had these experiences, and in fact more people have had ghostly experiences than even will admit. There's a huge segment of the population that in polls and surveys have acknowledged that they've had the experiences, but if you pull them, you know, I get people telling me stories all the time from major, you know, like doctors, lawyers, and other people, corporate executives when I meet them. When they, after they talk to me and find out that I'm a little bit more common sense and not crazy, then they'll tell me their story. But, and I always like to ask them, have you ever told anybody this story? And they haven't even told their spouses.
Right.
So it's not, you know, there is a lot of people, like with UFOs, who have not admitted. And then, there, of course, there are consequences for certain professions if they admit to seeing a UFO, like a pilot, even though pilots have seen UFOs all over the place. They have to be very careful because they could be removed or suspended for saying that.
I just find that strange. I just don't know what the difference would be if I would say, I was at an exorcism last month, or if I saw an alien.
If you said exorcism, you know, they have to, people have to be careful commenting, because if it's a religious belief,
right?
Then you get into some issues that could cause a lawsuit,
right? Yeah, if I say it in on U.S. media, I'll have to be have my lawyer. It's just silly. I'm just.
Well, let's take the UFO. Is an unidentified flying object. In other words, if you see something in the sky, you don't know what it is.
Right.
That's a UFO.
Yeah.
The question is, can we explain it? And for someone to say that they saw something that they didn't know what it was, and here's what it looked like, it's then the next step is to try to figure out what it could be that's not unexplainable. But it's not, you know, an alien. First of all, you really can't say that these are alien spacecraft for sure, because, you know, you'd have to have them land and make sure that there were aliens inside.
I also find that there's a big government thing. And you know, because right now, like whenever times are tough or things are struggling and all the stuff that's going on, you find that when people are, you know, scared of the government, you know, they're going to, and there's the thought of the, you know, the guns and all that going on, that the government's in conspiracy with the UFOs, with the aliens on the moon, and they know about it. See, whereas I guess ghosts don't have that. Like, it's not not like your president's in bed with a ghost. Or
well, I don't know. The White House is haunted. How do you know?
Joshua said that. Bob Warren.
I think you're right. And the conspiracy theorists, first of all, you have to define what a conspiracy is. I mean, a conspiracy technically could be three people in the government.
Yeah.
So to say that the U.S. government is in bed with UFOs, yes, it's possible if there are aliens visiting us that there's someone who's working with them, some agency or some small group of individuals. But that doesn't mean it's the government. And I think you have to be really careful. Martin Caden, who was a science and science fiction writer, he passed away in 1997. Who was somebody I got to know in the 90s very well. He,
Bionic Man.
Yeah, the Bionic, that's right.
Yeah.
$1 million man. He also wrote enormous amount of material on aviation because he was an aviation expert, and a lot about the space program because he was not only a space program expert and historian, he was also a consultant to NASA. And he, at one point in his career, was in military intelligence, and he did look into the UFO thing because he was interested. And what he found is that the best he could find out is that there is a lot of evidence that the military had that indicated that something was flying around our skies that they couldn't stop. Not who it was, not what it was, but just that there were things flying around that they couldn't stop. And the Pentagon, as he put it, in its infinite wisdom, would prefer to let people think that we know more than we do, because people then at least think the government is in control, versus there's something unknown we can't deal with.
Yeah. Yeah, it's there, you know, there's so much political bowl to all of this that it's just
yeah, it is. I mean, my latest book, ESP Wars, was about which I co-wrote with Ed May, who was the program director for our remote viewing program, the government's remote viewing program.
Right.
You know, that book goes deeply into the politics as well of the programs, and why they happen, why they shut down, and also with the Russians, because we had interviews from the Russians involved in this research for the first time ever. And last week, Newsweek puts out a major story about the remote viewing program and about a couple of the remote interviewed Ed and a couple of the remote viewers. And the very first line is Pentagon scientist, you know, starts out with Pentagon scientist. Ed was never a Pentagon scientist. And throughout the story is a hatchet job. I mean, it's like they threw everybody under the bus.
Right.
There's a never looked at both sides of the story. Really, the reporter very clearly did not want to say anything, say that there was anything to this, very clearly. But when you start out with a falsehood or an inaccuracy, both in the headline and in the article, in identifying who your principal is, how much can we believe the rest of the story?
Right, yeah. Yeah,
and we see that for the mainstream media. We see that in other places too. We certainly see that from Congress.
Yeah. Oh, terrible. Yeah, I can't believe how far it's gone. There's no.
Yeah.
I can't take any word. I cannot. We're constantly have CNN, of course, and Fox, and all this stuff running every day, and NPR, of course, is who I'm part of. But I just can't believe on every story that comes up. First of all, there has to be an editorial by some so-called professionals. But there's also, I feel like I need to check everything that I'm told.
Right. Well, like we do have the fact check. I think that is the case, because either the story is not fully reported, which is likely because an editor had to cut it down, chop it down, or it has a particular perspective or bias, depending on what the source is. I think a story that raises questions is a good story, as opposed to a story that just tells you, here's, you know, this is the entire story.
Yeah, 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 yeah. When they have a conclusions, and it's just so well, that's really interesting too. You know, the ESP wars. I think that was mm-hmm. one of the most. I think it's probably one of your most interesting parts of your life, I would guess. Right?
Yeah, I mean, I only got involved in that in the last few years. We are. Ed May, I'm meeting with Ed May tonight, in fact. We are going to be launching a Kickstarter in the next couple of weeks. I have to determine if we're going to do it right before or right after Thanksgiving, which will be to try to raise money to publish, to get published at least the first two volumes of what we think is going to be a five-volume set or series of the best of the declassified CIA material, because we have it. There's 89,000 pages.
Wow.
And it has to be gone through and picked through, and we're planning on doing volumes about, you know, with the best of the remote viewings, the results of the scientific experimentation on PK, as well as other, as well as remote viewing. I'm going to be in charge of a volume on the more political end of things, so getting to sort through political memos and the black budget and black project type things, which I find really fascinating. And then there'll be stuff. There's probably going to be at least two volumes on the best of the remote viewing. So it's some really good quality stuff. And Ed's actually been using Google Earth to look at the Soviet target, the old Soviet targets, which are still existing. The buildings still are there, even though they've been abandoned, and compare them against the drawings that were done in the 1980s by Joe McMonagle and Angela Ford and other people. And that's something they were never able to do before. And what's really interesting is that what he's seeing so far is dead on. Ingo Swann, apparently, who started the idea of remote viewing for the project, actually modeled something. He actually created a 3D model, rather than drawing or painting it, and Ed's been able to get, thanks to Google Earth, a picture of that location and some more information about it, and it matches. I mean, this is from the 1970s, where we had no spy satellites that could even look at these things.
Wow. I find that real fascinating, interesting area.
Yeah.
And I don't know why more I'll pick on the media. Why more media is not involved in so many more things with meat to it. Something that has some.
Well, we're hoping the Kickstarter will get some attention. We are we're looking. It's not a small one, because we have to. There's a lot of work that has to be done. Some graphics have to be
right.
Scanned and all sorts of stuff. So. We do have a publisher that's willing to print them, to do them, but we have to do all the work up front, and that's going to cost. They don't have the money to support the work to actually get there to the volumes.
Wow, that's just like, what brought you to that? Like, how did you all of a sudden jump into the ESP? And that's Russia and that, and
yeah. Well, I've been an educator in parapsychology since the early '80s, not just. Focused on, even though my field work is focused on apparitions, hauntings, and poltergeists, I have been teaching classes, grad school, non-academic, generally about parapsychology, and I've gotten to know a lot of my colleagues over the years in the Parapsychological Association. Ed May is here locally in the Bay Area. We hit it off even in the '80s when I didn't know he was doing this government project. He was doing some more public remote viewing research, by the way, so there was kind of a cover project happening too with remote viewing, but it was I guess the last 5 or 6 years we really reconnected and been hanging out a bit, and he had this manuscript that had been written by different people, including the translations from the Russians, that were disparate pieces and needed to be put together and gone through. And this is an area that has always been of interest to me. The remote viewing is really interesting. I've taught people to do remote viewing in some of my classes, in fact. And it's always been interesting to me. It's a superpower. It's like the comic book thing. So when he gave me the manuscript, I read through it, and it was had a lot of interesting meat to it, and I took it on as a project to rewrite it, to get more information from Ed and from the other sources, to pull from their source material a little bit more and come up with something that was cohesive, readable, and hopefully interesting to people.
Now, when you were doing the research, was there a real issue of coming back with how do you get the Russian side of it involved? Like how they're very secretive, right? You know.
Yeah. Well, you know, since the Cold War ended, Ed, in the early 90s, Ed, and as the project director of Stargate, this project, so it's probably the mid 90s. And Joe McMonagle, who became known as viewer number one, the best of the remote viewers, they were invited by the Russian counterparts to come over and visit. General Alexei Savin invited them over, and so they went over, and they got to know Alexei Savin and Boris Ratnikov and some of the remote viewers, and you know, this was no longer secretive because the Soviet Union was gone. So one of Ed's other colleagues, Victor Rubel, is a Russian national who was also here in the States, lived here in the States, and he was able to get interviews with Ratnikov and Savin, both of whom ran or worked in the remote viewing and other psychic spying type stuff, and then with several Russian scientists because of this. Again, it's not been closed off since the fall of the Soviet Union. And in fact, Ed's going over there in a couple of weeks with Joe McMonagle and I believe Angela Ford, another one of the viewers. They've been invited over for the launch party of the Russian version of ESP Wars, which was actually written before I got involved, so I'm not involved in that. But while they're there, they're planning on doing some video interviews with Savin and Ratnikov and Nikolai Sham and a couple other folks, get them on video, so we actually have not just an audio recording that's been translated, but also these folks on video. And going further into what they did, they're even hopefully going to visit the only existing Typhoon-class submarine, Akira-class submarine, which was the target of Joe McMonagle's viewing while it was being built in a warehouse. The submarine, which was the kind of submarine they had in the Hunt for Red October, it still exists, and no American group has ever been, media group, nobody from TV has ever been allowed to film it. And Ed has an invitation to take a crew and shoot the sub. So not just for remote viewing purposes, but also for historical purposes, they're going to get some really cool stuff.
Wow. So now, let's talk about you here. Now, you are also doing what? You're teaching classes, aren't you? Or are you giving?
I teach classes in a couple different locations in different modalities. I teach for the Rhine Education Center, Rhine Research Center. That's R-H-I-N-E. That's the Rhine Research Center is the legacy lab of J.B. Rhine. It used to be the Duke lab back in the up until the mid-60s, and we have online courses. So mid-January there'll be an 8-week online introduction to parapsychology course, which I'll be teaching, and then also we're doing a couple of short classes in there as well, some 4-week classes. I teach courses through a location here in the Bay Area, very non-academic, called HCH Institute. And we have actually a series of classes, which if you take them all, you get a certificate. And they're introductory overview classes, fairly deep, and I give my students a lot of supplemental material as part of the class. And people can take them locally, or they can attend live by phone, or they can work with me on a distance version, which is audio-based and phone-based. So I actually get one-on-one with my students, phone or Skype, as well. So there are a lot of options for that. And, you know, they can find out more about them. The Rhine Center, the thing to do is just go to Rhine, R-H-I-N-E.org, and just look for the education link on the left-hand side. You can go to my website, mindreader.com, and also link out to the Rhine Center that way. But there's one of the drop-down menus talks about the Parapsychological Studies Certificate Program, or you can just simply email me from my website. you'll also get on my email newsletter. That way, and find out about my classes. And then I'm occasionally going to be doing webinars with the Forever Family Foundation, and I'll be teaching in a few other places as well.
Wow, it's fascinating, and I definitely want to hook up that. I know years back I took some courses with Karen O'Keefe.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
Yeah, he's off the classes. Yeah, there are a couple of, for educational opportunities, if you go to the Azire, theazire.org, that's Nancy Zingroni and Carlos Alvarado, and or you can just go to WizIQ, which is a platform, a learning platform, and they offer a couple of free classes every year in parapsychology as well. There's more and more opportunities because we're able to get online and because we're able to use technology to deliver everything from teleseminars to webinars to online courses and other things. So it's not that people should be lacking for opportunities to learn. It's just whether they have the drive and want to spend a little bit of money, because these are not terribly expensive courses.
Oh, yeah. No, well worth it. Well worth it. You know, we just can't. I want to learn more and more. The older I get, I want to know more. It's,
and you know, we're always hoping that the ghost hunting groups will somehow wake up and realize that they can up their game. They can actually really do much better if they actually learn something.
Whether
it's reading a book.
Yeah.
Starting with reading a book, or at least going to the websites of the parapsychology folks as opposed to the websites of other ghost hunters. And starting there, I mean, there's lots of free opportunities, and I'm happy to point people in those directions as well, much as I'd like them to take my classes. But there's plenty of free opportunities, and I'm happy to point people in the right direction for those.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah. I really don't think that the... I think that most of these groups and stuff will be gone in 10 years.
Well, they typically fracture, split... So the original group is often gone, and then there's some other new group. So it's like generational in some respects.
Yeah.
I knew of, there were a couple groups. There's still one group in Seattle called A Ghost that's been around for a long time, for well over 10 years.
Yeah.
And that group, people in that group split off and split off and split off. You know, one group actually spawned like 25 other groups because the people didn't like the approach that the initial people had, which was frankly a little bit more educational.
Yeah.
And that's the problem, is you have, you know, people come in, they're sometimes really good groups, and then the people who come in and say, oh, this is bogus, I have to learn something, forget that, I don't want to do that, I'll start my own group.
Yeah. What about the t-shirts?
Well, you know, here's my biggest problem with t-shirts, and the van signs and everything like that.
Yeah.
Can't promise confidentiality to a family and then show up at their house with a car or van with a big sign on it and t-shirts and jackets that have logos indicating you're ghost hunters. You can't offer confidentiality to people, and you need to offer that. So that's great to wear out to advertise yourselves, but that very thing is ridiculous. And you don't see Jason and Grant doing that.
Yeah.
Or Zach doesn't do that. I mean, they don't wear Ghost Adventures t-shirts.
No, but he's got a look. So.
Yeah, well, there's a look. Yeah, okay. You can have a stylist give you a look. That's
fine. He's got a look, right? So it's the hair and everything. So he's
right.
No, it's just terrible. No, I think what I mean is that most of these, I think a lot of the fad will wear away.
I think a lot of people are
on it and jumping, and it's the cool thing to do right now. It's the Lady Gaga thing to do, and I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying that I could just see how. In 10 years, something else being the thing to do.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Plus, you know, the demographics of ghost hunting groups are pretty much consistent across the country and across the world. So as those folks get older and less younger people get involved and interested, and fortunately we're seeing more and more younger people who are actually questioning what is going on. So they're rather than joining ghost hunting groups, they are starting to wake up that there's more to these experiences.
Right.
And that's where we're kind of the hope of the future is. It's certainly not with the ghost hunting groups, it looks like.
Yeah, yeah. I think that, I'm hoping anyway, but I mean, it's...
Yeah.
have to be careful. I've got other shows that I have to talk with some of those people with.
Right. Well, you know, I think their interest. All I want to see is that they are honest about their interest.
Yeah.
If they're thrill seekers, admit that. And
yeah.
Don't try to work with people who are in distress. You know, I have no problem with people who are honest about their experiences. I've talked to many ghost hunters who are only in it to try to have an experience. I have no problem with them whatsoever because they're honest about it. It's when they start claiming to be professionals and start, you know, denigrating any educational opportunity or saying that people should not be offering classes for money because you can't be an expert in this. And, you know, I have a graduate degree in this. That's an educational degree with education behind it. So
right.
For some of these folks to say that there are no experts or people who know what they're talking about indicates their ignorance more
yeah.
than anything.
Yeah, yeah. So what do you, just for suggestions, what do you think that people should read? Do you have any?
I will recommend Deborah Blum's book, The Ghost Hunters. It reads like a novel. It's about the early investigators and why they got into this and some of the early phenomena. And I really heartily recommend that one as just simply a fun thing to read. So you know where you came from, so to speak. But for a good introduction, one of the more interesting books out there, which is a little bit old, but it's been reprinted, and it really will give you at least a basis. It's a book called Psychic Exploration, by was edited by Edgar Mitchell, the Apollo 14 astronaut. Was reprinted a couple of years ago, and it's readily available on Amazon. It'll give you a good understanding of all sorts of areas around parapsychology, including chapters on apparitions, hauntings, and poltergeists. There's a book called Entangled Minds, if you have any interest in quantum physics and psychic ability. There's a section in that book which is written by Dean Radin, R-A-D-I-N, which gives you a good summary of research in parapsychology, and it's written for the layperson, so it's not like you have to think hard about understanding. You mentioned my book, The Ghost Detective's Guide to Haunted San Francisco, and that's, rather than being a directory about places in San Francisco, it's really, it was co-written by a psychic medium named Annette Martin, who passed away a couple years ago, and we provide you with a narrative of our investigation of only a few places in the Bay Area and San Francisco proper, and one outside, and how we worked together, and what she picked up as a medium, and how I looked at things as a parapsychologist. So it's a good, very readable, fun book on how a psychic and a parapsychologist work together and in haunted places. So you can kind of get a narrative and some fun stuff there. So those are good starts.
And I think that's really important that you say that. I was going to bring it around somehow that now, and this isn't, I don't want people to get the idea that you're slamming psychics or a total disbeliever in mediums. You have a need for some reality. Like, so you actually believe that there are mediums and legitimate ones.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, as president of the Forever Family Foundation, I work with a number, I've met many of the mediums that we've had certified. Julie Beischel at the Winbridge Institute has taken 20 mediums, there's now only 19 of them around, who have gone through a one-year, very ultra-controlled research process to be vetted as research mediums, certified research mediums. There are people who have put out incredibly evidential material. And I've worked with psychics, regularly since the mid-80s and even before that a little bit when I first got into the field. You just have to find the right people. And just like with anybody else, it's not just do they come up with information that's accurate, can you work with them? And there's many psychics who I've not been able to work with because of their personality conflicts, not because they're not good psychics, but because of personality conflicts. Mm-hmm. So that's another thing we have to look at. Let's face it, the devices everybody uses we don't know what we're trying to detect. So there is no such thing as a ghost detector at this moment, except for a human being or an animal, because we have psychic experiences. So the witnesses themselves who have seen ghosts can be used as ghost detectors. Psychics can be used as ghost detectors. You know, so it's about people. It's not about, the tech supports the experience of the people rather than the other way around.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And my Ouija board. No, just...
I've never used one in a case. I've used an Etch-a-Sketch in a case, but...
Well, there you go. That's a new angle.
seeing if the ghost can actually do with anything with it. We actually had a case where the people showed me the etch-a-sketch that had been left, that overnight had ended up with a very beautiful curved cursive "help me" on it, which would take somebody hours to do with an etch-a-sketch. So what the hell, we bring it along. The Ouija board comes off of your unconscious mind. It's no different than dowsing rods. It's no different than pendulums. None of those things are necessarily going to be tools that you can really use to communicate.
Right. Yeah, I just think they're all items. This is you can take any item. I still refer to it like a cell phone. It's not the creator of what we think is evil or a demon. You know, it's not
right,
like it's,
right.
You know, like... I just, some people are so scared of it.
Biggest problem with the Ouija board is if you approach it like you're afraid you might get something, it's tapping into your unconscious if you're using it by yourself or to who knows who's unconscious if you're using it with more than one person. And that's where nightmares come from.
Yeah.
So your expectation of getting something possibly evil is going to probably let your unconscious go, ooh, let's have some fun.
Yeah.
Not an outside spirit.
Yeah, certainly an interesting field. Well, I have to say thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
I'm glad you were able to come and redo the show for me. Very important. I like intelligent conversations on the subject, so this is a great show, and hope to have you on again.
Sure, Al. That sounds great.
The mission has been completed.
The end!
By George, he's got it! It is the end!
I'll see you!
This has been a production of the Z-Talk Radio Network.
If you're lying to me, I'll be back.